which will deal by Saish Dalal Ismail, one of the MMed student, prominent and promising MMed student. So he will speak on the different softwares in online teaching and education. And I'm happy that this lecture is very good for you. It's very stimulating one, definitely. So I invite Vaishali Deshai for introducing the resource person. Vaishali, please.
Yes, sir. Hello and good morning, everyone, and welcome to today's session. It is now my great pleasure to introduce Mr. Saish Naik Dalal, our speaker for today's session. Mr. Saish Naik Dalal is currently M.Ed. second year student of GVM's Dr. Dada Vaidhi College of Education. He has done post-graduation in English. He has also completed Bachelor in Education and also qualified NTA UGC NET year 2019 in education. He has published research papers in UGC CARE listed and Scopus listed journals, presented about 10 research papers at national and international level seminars. He has always been active in research work and has also conducted 8 workshops on online teaching at state level and the national level. He has been the convener for various international and national seminars too. Presently, he is the joint secretary of Govan Forum for Educational Research and Promotion. Formerly, he has also worked as an editor, designer of Marathi magazine published by GVM Dr. Dada Vaidhi College of Education from 2018 to 2020. He has also been the sub-editor of Seminar Compendium, published of paper of national seminars. We would love to hear from you, Mr. Saish Naik Dalal. Over to you, Mr. Dalal.
Yeah, my screen is visible. Yeah, okay. Yes, yes, I'll count you first. Okay. Yes, sir. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. And finally, welcome to the last session of this international conference. I am really honored to be here in front of you all, and also the esteemed participants who have come from all across different countries, across different continents, and they are here for this session, and they have been here throughout the session. So welcome to all, and my topic for the day is free open source softwares for ICT based education. Now we all know that during the recent pandemic, there has been a drastic or a vibrant shift from the regular classroom environment and the teaching practices which we were used to all these years to a more online or technology-based teaching. And that is something wherein most of the teachers, I can say, in India or some other countries have experienced problem as to how to shift from a technology How to shift from a classroom chalkboard based teaching to a technology based teaching. Now, considering the computer literacy aspect, it is easy to learn a software, but it is difficult to find a software which is good enough and that can adhere to your needs. Okay, so we all know about normal softwares like Microsoft Office, or then there is Microsoft Office, the most commonly used software, all know. And Windows and all others, but We also know that these are the softwares which you require to pay, and there is a heavy price on those softwares. Microsoft Office, a normal student edition, also comes for something 6,000 rupees, a lifetime license. And if you are going for the Office 365 one, then it is 4,000 per year. So these are very expensive softwares, and not everyone and anyone can afford it. Now, considering the teacher's angle, at least teachers are working, they are earning salary, so maybe they can afford to spend some. But what about the students who are not working anywhere? Okay, and the students who do not have access to buy some heavy technology or good laptop or something. So how can they use, or how can they manage to get ICT-based education? So for this, the most, actually the free open source software that we are dealing with today is the best possible way for anyone to use technology in their day-to-day life, and also now for technology in education. But the problem is many of us don't know or are not aware of what is ICT based or what is free open source software. So it is commonly known as the FOSS. So my topic for the day here is free open source software. So let's see first. My today's presentation will go on details about what is free open source software, its history, a brief introduction to it, and then I will come to the different softwares that we can actually use in our day-to-day life, which are available free. Okay, so coming to the first slide, what is a FOSS? Okay, it is commonly known as FOSS. It is a free open source software. It is a software that can be classified as both free and open source. Now, what do you mean by open source? Okay, open source is something, earlier if you go, then software, okay, history, I'll come to the history part later. Open source is basically a software whose source code is not locked by the company. Okay, so anyone having that software can get access to its source code and edit the software as per their need. And free software, okay, so you don't have to pay for that software. That is, anyone is freely licensed to use. The license of that software is free to use, copy, study, and change the software in any way. And the source code is openly shared to all the people and encouraged to voluntarily improve the design of the software. That's why you will see further that many of the softwares are highly competitive, and they are competing the mostly highly paid softwares also. Okay, so whichever expensive softwares you are aware about, like Photoshop maybe, then Photoshop or something like CorelDRAW or like that, those software which are paid, they can be replaced by this free open source software. So let's see. Proprietary software. Okay, now what are proprietary softwares? Proprietary softwares are those software, this is in contrast to the proprietary software, where the software is under restrictive copyright licenses and the source code is usually hidden from the users. Okay, so these are the softwares like our Windows, Microsoft Office, then Adobe Photoshop, then Adobe Premiere, you can say CorelDRAW, or there are many different kinds of softwares wherein you have to pay to buy that software. Even on mobile phones, there are various softwares which are available only if you can pay them. Otherwise, you are not allowed. You get a free trial version, but they do not provide all the necessary or all the features that are available for the paid version. Hence, people normally try to go for a software which has less features and is available free. Okay, but we are not aware that all these features of the paid software are also available in the free open source software. So let's first see what is proprietary software, a detail about it. Okay, these are the pay and use software, license based software. So you have to buy a license, you cannot copyright or you cannot copy a license from someone else. And examples of this are Windows operating system, Microsoft Office, and Adobe Reader or Adobe PDF Reader, you have Adobe Photoshop. Okay, so these are some of the companies that manufacture the proprietary softwares. Okay, next, using proprietary softwares. Okay, in India, we commonly use what is called as the cracked version or the pirated version of a software. So we have a habit, like whenever we buy a laptop or a PC, we tend to install Microsoft Office, which if it is not default installed by default, we install it, and then we don't pay for it exactly. We ask our friend to just give us one software, mache galun dire. Okay, we do some kind of things like that. We borrow it from our friends and we use it. But we don't go to buy the actual original version of that software. Illegal sale of software available in cyber cafes and other computer repair shops. Okay, so even when you're buying a laptop from maybe any showroom, if that laptop has a Linux operating system, you will ask the person to please install Windows and give it to you, because you are not used to using Linux and you will prefer to use Windows, which you are familiar to. Okay, so that is one reason why we always opt for illegal software rather than buying a free software, using a free software. But one thing we must remember is cyber laws prohibit piracy and sale of pirated softwares. Okay, so actually anyone or all of us, basically whoever are using pirated softwares, we are actually committing a crime under the cyber law. And the punishment in India is not very strict actually. We don't see anybody getting arrested for using a pirated Windows or a pirated Microsoft, but Microsoft Office. But in other countries, some countries, they have taken their cyber laws very strictly, and the country law and legislature, they strictly arrest those people who are using pirated version. So you have to use the paid version, proper licensed version of any software which you want to use. Okay, so high priced software like Adobe Photoshop, Premiere, CorelDRAW, etc., like Windows also, Microsoft Office, they have their own piracy policies. Okay, so whenever you install a pirated software, don't think that you are totally safe. Whenever you install a pirated Windows, whenever you install a pirated Microsoft Office, okay, that time, and if you are using internet on that device, the company already knows that you are using a pirated version. And that's why you can always check out. You will not get access to all the free themes or all the templates. Basically, those who are using PowerPoint, you will see that the extra templates which are available online will not be available to you. Okay, many features in Word are also not available. So various features, slowly in PowerPoint, some features will start being disabled, or you will experience your system slowing down if you are using a pirated Windows. So this kind of problems are seen when you are using a pirated software. So each software company has its own detection of pirated software. It has the policy. Okay, they have some codes in their software by which they can detect if the system using a software is original or it is a pirated version. Okay, so drawbacks of using pirated software is fear of system crash. Okay, so your system, your software, your operating system can experience severe problem, okay, functioning problem anytime. You cannot say like, oh, now it is good, and suddenly you go somewhere, your system is not starting. This is because the company knows that you are using a pirated version, and slowly they will feed your system some data by which you have to format your entire PC. Okay, so these things happen. Your system may crash suddenly, system doesn't open up. Okay, attack from virus and other malware. So this is common. Most computer companies, the software companies, do this kind of things to make you uninstall their pirated version. Restricted access to the resources otherwise available on the paid version. So like I said, on PowerPoint, you can access thousands of different templates on different themes, but if you're not using a paid version, you don't get access to any of those. Also, PowerPoint and other softwares have system like 3D models, other things, export to a video, export to a PDF. This kind of options are locked. On some softwares, you don't get to export your file into the size that you want you to. So if you're using a Adobe Premiere or you're using Photoshop, then some features you will find are disabled or not even visible there. Okay, and if someone has used CorelDRAW or Photoshop, you will also notice that if you connect, okay, so I'll come there, yeah. Restricted access, can't do online activities while using pirated softwares. So if you are using a pirated software like Photoshop or CorelDRAW, your online activity usage will be limited, because if that software is connected to network, then it will automatically create problem for your software functioning. They will come to know that you are using a pirated version, and hence you will be unable to use that software again. And to reinstall the crack or anything, you have to format your entire system and start again. So that becomes difficult for us to use the software. No access to regular updates and upgrades provided by the company. Okay, so there any software it may be, there are always bugs or some crashes which the software has. There are some errors or some problems which the software will have, small problems. Or there will be a feature update which is there. They will add some features to your software. So this kind of upgrades you won't get with the pirated version. The company does not give you any updates. So even if your Windows, if it is pirated, you can go to updates and try updating. It will not update because it asks for the license and it requires a proper license and the user account to upgrade the software. Okay, cloud networking and common workspace also not possible. So on Microsoft Word or on Adobe also, they have their own cloud system like online storage, which you can use using your Gmail or email account, any account. Once you create an account on Microsoft or Adobe software or CorelDRAW or any other paid software, they will give you access to their online storage. And these access are only provided to those who are using a paid version of that software. So if you try to create an Outlook account of your Word on OneDrive, which is Microsoft's online storage, it will not give you access to the Word and PowerPoint if your softwares are not paid one. It will ask you to install Office 365 online, or it will ask you to buy a paid version, something like that. You will always find that notification, activate your Windows, the license has expired, something like that are always there. So these are the various drawbacks which one can see of the paid or the pirated softwares given by the proprietary software companies. Because all they want is their software should be used by people who can pay for it and not use it for free. Okay, so why we use pirated software? Now this is very important when we come to educational technology or technology in education as we are saying it. So paid software are costly, that is the first thing. Okay, if you try to buy Photoshop just for fun also, it will cost around 2500 rupees per month. Okay, so that's just one software. If you are using video editors like Adobe Premiere or Sony Vegas Pro, they cost around 3500 per month. Okay, so no one can afford that much of payment for software if you are not using it for professional work. Paying 3500 or 2500 per month is not possible. CorelDRAW, something like that software, CorelDRAW software costs around 60,000 for the license. Okay, the latest one. So this kind of thing, Microsoft Office, it costs around 5,000 per year or 400 per month, like that. There are various options to buy. So we do not want to spend that much money on software. We prefer downloading a cracked version or a pirated version and install it. Just to finish, just that our needs are managed. That's all we look at. Then we use, that's coming to the second point, need and work oriented. Because we become limited with whatever the software is available, whatever the software makes us available, only those features we will use, and we will limit our work and need only to that much. So if you need only for typing purpose, you will just install Word and just do the typing work. You won't go to explore the other features which are available on Microsoft Word. Okay, so it is need and work oriented. Limited knowledge of available software. So this is where our today's session comes in. Most of us are not aware to use the free open source softwares capably, or they do not know that there is something called as free open source softwares which are available for free, and all features are available for free of the free open source software. So there is nothing where you have to pay them and buy something like that. There are no loopholes, as we say, in those softwares. So fear of accepting new technology. New technology is in now, see, same way I gave you an example of if you buy a software online, a laptop from a shop, and if it has a Linux operating system, we will choose not to use Linux and we will ask them to install and give us Windows operating system. So this is where we need to improvise ourselves as we are moving to an online teaching based school. So we have to make a habit of using technology that is new. Okay, so free open source softwares are one of the best alternatives for any software or any educational need that we have. Secondly, we come to the point that not properly introduced to free open source softwares. Okay, so we are all taught in school that there is Microsoft Office, there is PowerPoint, there is this and that and that. But we are never properly introduced to what is a free open source software. We are only taught about one software and we use that only one software for throughout, for all our work. If we know to use Word and PowerPoint, we will only use Word and PowerPoint. But we are not looking at the option that Google also allows you to use Google Docs and Google Slides for free, which is as good as PowerPoint, besides some few features are missing here and there. But rest, all our work can be done as good as the paid Word and PowerPoint will give you on Google Slides and Google Docs. Okay, so we need to explore more softwares that which we can use in our daily work and get our work done very smoothly. Okay, so again the same thing, not aware of free open source software. So in today's session, we will see about different kinds of softwares which are available under the free open source software license. Okay, so this free open source softwares are the alternative to proprietary software. Let's look at a little history of it. Until a free open source software initiative was founded in 1998, but this idea of free softwares was not 1998, was not in 1998, but it was much before that. Until 1970, all software were provided free with the hardware. Okay, so whenever you see the old pictures of Steve Jobs or Bill Gates working in their like shed outside the house, those times the person only had to pay for the hardware and all the software were given free with the hardware. Okay, so there was no concept actually of selling a software. Later, some companies decided to lock the source code of the software. So then they realized that some people were using their source code and modifying the software for different purposes. Hence, here comes something called as the IPR, Intellectual Property Rights issue. We can definitely agree that any software is the intellectual property of a developer, that is a person who is developing the software and the software company. Okay, so it's the people's intellectual property and it is not good to take someone's property free of cost. And or maybe you can take it free of cost and then you will end up selling it to someone. So this is not right. So both arguments at that time were correct. The conflict between those supporting free software and paid software led to the starting of FOSS. So this is just a brief history that I have given to you all, how the free open source softwares were started. So those who believe that software or the programming developing knowledge should be open, free, available to all, and those who believed in paying for the software or protecting the intellectual property of the developer, their conflict ended up in developing something called as the free open source software. Okay, so now coming to the main part of this session, free open source software for education. Now we are facing a pandemic and all our educational things are happening online, and teachers or all educators of different sorts require softwares which are accessible to them easily and also will not limit their work. Okay, so if a free paid software is giving you this many features, the other software, non-paid software, should also be able to provide that many features to the user. So that is where the role of FOSS comes into education. FOSS was developed with the aim that everyone should get access to using computers for educational purposes. Okay, so anyone who was using a computer should not actually be derived from using the educational software effectively. Okay, so if there is someone who has somehow managed to buy a computer, should not be put into a situation where he should also collect money to buy the software required for the education. Okay, so that should be available to him for free, or that person for free. So that is why the FOSS was actually developed for education purposes. So the biggest challenge for the FOSS was actually Microsoft Office. Developing an alternative for Microsoft Office was the most toughest job they ever had, but that was good. Affording paid proprietary software is not possible for everyone. Hence, no one should be left out of using computers. So this was the main idea. there is an alternative FOSS for all proprietary software. Okay, so there is an alternative free open source software available for every proprietary software, or basically to fulfill each and every need of the individual. Let's take a look. Okay, so these are the list of some paid softwares that we use on daily basis. So many of you all will be familiar to some of these, but this is a brief list of software. So let's see. First, starting, we have the operating system, that is the Windows 7, 8, 8.1 and 10. So these are the Windows is the most pirated used software in India, we can say. Because no one actually goes to buy a Windows for 20,000 or 25,000, the paid one. We normally prefer to use the pirated version. Then there is Microsoft Office. The entire range of softwares available under Microsoft Office are paid. So we have the Word, we have the PowerPoint, Excel, Publisher, then Microsoft Teams, we have Access, then various softwares are there. Okay, so all these come under Microsoft Office and they are all paid. Then we have Photoshop of Adobe, we have Adobe Premiere, it is there, then CorelDRAW. Okay, CorelDRAW is by Corel Systems. Then Adobe Premiere, video editors like Sony Vegas Pro, or there are many other editors which are available. DaVinci is there, then Acrobat PDF Reader. Okay, now Google Chrome. Why I have mentioned Google Chrome? Google Chrome is not actually a paid software, but it is not also a free open source software. So I have mentioned that. And audio editors are there, different. Adobe Audition is there, Sony SoundForge is there, and there are many other audio editors which are available but for paid. And also some image processors which are available for paid as a paid software. And there are many other pirated softwares which we use on daily basis, like different converters, online YouTube downloaders, or then something like audio to video converter or JPEG to PDF converters. These are all softwares which are available paid. Okay, mobile. One thing we can know is there are some mobile apps which can also function as an alternative to this paid software. But we don't always buy mobiles that have a good processor and high speed of processing. Okay, so using software effectively on mobile is not possible for everyone as it is on laptop. Because laptop supports a better software and better speed or better weight, as we can say. Better processing as compared to what the mobile will support. But still, I will give you a few examples what are available on mobile. We have the entire G Suite, that is the Google Suite. Wherein we have the Google Docs, the Google Sheets, Google Slides, Google Forms, Google Classroom, then Google Meet, Google Hangouts, Gmail, Google Drive, and the list goes on. Okay, there is Google Maps also for geography people. When you make use of those Google Maps. So the Google has also provided a big range of softwares which you can use on daily basis. But let's see what FOSS is there. Okay, so coming to the first free open source software, that is the LibreOffice Suite. This is kind of a competitive or the free open source software version of Microsoft Office, and it has a variety of software just like MS Office will provide you. I've given a list here and also the logos of those softwares. You can see LibreOffice Suite is available to use free of source, free of cost, and the downloading size of the software is something around 350 MB. So you can see it is very light to use, and also it has a lot of functions similar to the Microsoft Office. So we have the LibreOffice Writer, which is the alternative for Microsoft Word. We have LibreOffice Calc, that is the alternative for Microsoft Excel. We have LibreOffice Impress as an alternative for Microsoft PowerPoint, Office PowerPoint. Then there is this LibreOffice Math, which is an additional software available for us to use. Okay, so this is for math, those who want to insert some formulas or show stepwise how to solve a sum and all. They can use this LibreOffice Math. And there is the LibreOffice Draw for those who wish to draw or create some images to be sent to their student or for any use. Okay, so I will go into all these softwares in detail, a short brief actually, not in detail, in brief. So let's see, the first software is LibreOffice Impress. Okay, this software is very similar to PowerPoint. You can see the image that has come up. Yes, you can see. Am I audible? Okay. Okay, the image has come up. Yeah, okay. So the image has come up, which is there. That is the free open source LibreOffice Impress. Okay, you can see the interface of the software is very similar to that of PowerPoint. And there is all the icons. Okay, so first one thing important which you have to remember is you can see the icons. These icons are very similar to that which are used in the office. And these are the universal icons. So it will be similar throughout any software that you will ever use. Okay, similar functioning it will have. Okay, the functioning of those software is very the icons is very similar. So you can see there are options like file, edit, view, insert, format, slide, slideshow and tools. Okay, so I didn't go into the file and edit and view option because they are similar to PowerPoint. But this is very interesting. This allows you to add images online and offline, audio or video, chart, table, media, object, shapes, then text box, exactly same as how the PowerPoint will allow you. Okay. So you can see the interface also on the left and right hand side. There are the layouts. If you want to add a title and description with content, comparison slide, only title, then heading slide, title with two contents and like this. So contrast, different types of layouts are available to you for use. Okay, next when you go to the slide option, you can create a new slide, a duplicate a slide, insert slide from other files, then set background image, properties, change slide master, master background, master objects. So these are various customizable options available to the user. And it is as good as the PowerPoint. So there is no much difference in the using PowerPoint and this software. Okay, even the interface is same. Next, when you go to slideshow, again the same option, start from first slide, start from current slide, custom slideshow, slideshow settings, rehearse timings. Okay, all these softwares are, all these settings are available. Next, yeah, okay, so this is the basic interface of how the screen will appear, and there are different templates which are available. You can download templates online also. So this is the basic outlay of PowerPoint or the Impress. Okay, next software is LibreOffice Math. Now this is ideal for inserting math equations which is otherwise difficult on Word. Okay, Word and PowerPoint also have this option, but it is easier on LibreOffice Math than it is on the other software. I will show you the interface. You can see there is, I don't understand much maths, but there is this plus sign, the minus, the plus minus. Okay, then there is this two blocks, a different division, multiplication, and fraction. Okay, so there are variety of signs which are available, degrees. Okay, so then there is this option here where you get variety of options also. You can see once you click on that, you will find unary binary operators, relations, set operation, functions, operator attributes, brackets, formats and various other examples. So all kinds of, I won't say all, but most of the used equations can be, or mathematical writings can be done using this software. Okay, so you can see some example. There are some formulas which are there. Okay, the E is equal to MC square. Then a square plus b square is equal to c square, Pythagoras. So all these things are available over here. So you can definitely try out. The math teachers who are having problem can surely go for this software. LibreOffice Writer. Okay, now this is the efficient word processing software like the Microsoft Word or Google Docs. This is very similar to those softwares. You can see this, the interface is very similar to that of Microsoft Office 2010 edition, I think, or the 13th one. It is not good as similar to the latest one, but it is very good. It has all the features we require for our daily use. Okay, so you can see this is the interface. There is the ruler on top, the bold, italics, underline, then subscripts, overscript, all options are there. Fonts are there, different fonts, styles, and there is the file option, edit option, view. You can export as a PDF, or many other options are available. Okay, so when you go to the insert column, you can find similar options like the PowerPoint was providing us, or the Impress of the free open source was providing. You can insert an image. You can insert chart, media, object, shapes, text box. Then you can insert links, cross-referencing, formatting. Everything is available. Footnote, endnote. Okay, headers, footers, everything is there. You know, when you go to format, you have the text formatting, spacing, alignment, lists. Okay, you can copy formatting, character, paragraph, bullets, numbering, page styles. Okay, so various types of formattings are available, similar to how they are available on the Microsoft Word. And we have the styles. You can see, you can definitely explore this software. It is very easy, does not take much time to explore it, and anyone who has used Microsoft Word can easily figure out how to use this software. Okay, so these are just the various options that are available on. Okay, so now we are coming to the next software. I haven't put here the Excel, it is the Calc. Okay, LibreOffice Calc, I have not included in my presentation, but you can also explore that. Now we are coming to Inkspace. Okay, Inkspace is a designing and creating software, which is very similar to CorelDRAW, but this is available free, and many of its features are very similar to the CorelDRAW software. Even the interface to a large extent is similar to CorelDRAW. Okay, so anyone who has done drawing or designing or tried to create an image for your presentations, you can definitely give a try to this software. It is available free. Okay, so let's see how the software looks. This is the basic outlet of the interface of the software. You can see that we have the layering option also available for us. Add a layer, rename layer. Okay, those who have worked with layerings, they will know what these options are. You can see they are very effective, and you can get your work done very easily. So then you have this different options on the left hand side, a square, circle, 3D items, spirals. Okay, these are the icons which you will find also on the CorelDRAW, very similar to this. And these are a bit colored, and the CorelDRAW uses a bit of black and white touch for the icons. But they are similar, and all the functioning in the software is also very similar to the CorelDRAW. Okay, you have objects, you can use fill and stroke, object properties, you can symbol, and you have different blending options which are available, and all kinds of other options that are required for you to create a good design or an image. Okay, next there is a path and different option. I'm not a good designer, so I'm not very familiar with this kind of options that are available, but still I'm showing you all how it looks overall. Next we have the different filters that are available for any image. You can use the bevels, the blurs, bumps, color, distort, transparency, image effect, paint draw effect, morphology. So these are all technical terms, and you can explore them slowly, and they are very useful and very effective. Okay, so that was the Inkspace, and now we are coming to another important software for graphics and designing, that is the GIMP. GIMP is the GNU Image Manipulation Program. Okay, so the GNU is the short form for the company. You can check it out, and the editing photos like Photoshop. The use of this software is you can edit photos just like Photoshop. So all the features of Photoshop are available over here. I'll show you this outline. Okay, so you can see the color of the software is also very similar to Photoshop. Just the interface has a bit of change. Okay, the Photoshop interface looks a little bit different as compared to the GIMP, but still All the features, if you compare, are very similar to what is available on Photoshop. Okay, you can see that there are feather, sharpen and all other options which are available. You can select photos, and I have tried to edit this image, so I have removed the sky from above and just tried to keep this. Then there is again the image correction option which are available, crop, then fit to size, transform images. Okay, then there is again the layering option. You can work in more than 5 layers in this software. That is very impressive of the software. And then you can set edit images over here, color balance, color temperature, then the use, the saturation, exposure, shadows, highlights, all the brightness, contrast, different things. Each and every aspect of photo editing is available here. So you can definitely try it out. And if you see over here, all the options which are available on Photoshop in a vertical row, it is available here in a grid kind of a way. Okay, this is the selection, the dragging, then the lasso tool, then cropping tool, then there are different other kinds of tools. There is the paint, the eraser, the clone stamp, and there are word typing. Okay, so different softwares are there. Even you can blur your photo, enhance, distort, light and shadow adjustment, all different features which are there on Photoshop are available here. And this software is also not heavy. It is something around 300 MB or 400 MB. And easily download and install it. Okay, coming next to the Free Minds, that is the mind mapping software. You can create different mind maps, different images. Okay, different concept maps as we know. These are the memory techniques which we have developed over the period of time, which are there. And many people use it to remember things, or different locations, or different objects, or different points. Even for exams, we use this kind of techniques to help us remember a topic better. Okay, so Free Minds is one of the mind mapping software which is available free and under the free open source software license. So you can create mind maps, you can create flow charts, you can create memory enhancement. It is good for memory enhancement. So let's see. Okay, so I have tried to create a small map over here. This is my home. 5:30 in the morning, get up at 6 a.m. Okay, so it is not a big map as such, but this is how you can create a schedule or a timetable for yourself, which is available. You can see different kinds of logos are available on the left hand side, numbers, arrows, smileys, pins, attachment, then house, workplace, post, mail, phone, music, different logos adhering to a particular work or a particular job is available there. Okay, so and you have the options of adding notes, the child notes, sibling notes, and different kinds of options which are there. So you can create an effective mind map using this. You can even add links and different images to your mind map in this, and you can create a good concept map or even your notes of exams or anything. You can create this way using this software. Yeah, next we come to this very familiar software which we all know, that is the VLC player, that is the Video LAN Community, which is the full form of VLC. Okay, so we all must be using this software now and then, every time to watch videos and movies and all, but we don't know that it is a free open source software, because we are used to downloading stuff free from internet. So we somewhere forget the line between the free open source software and a freely downloaded software. Okay, so VLC is a free open source software which supports number of formats in media. Okay, so it is not limited like my Windows Media Player. Windows Media Player is a very limited support to different medias, but VLC supports a wide variety of medias formats, and now it has also provided 4K support. So it is, and the best part is it is available for free on all platforms including Android. So if you ever have a problem playing a video on your mobile phone, you can definitely go to Play Store and download a VLC player. For those who are using Mac, you are using Windows, or you are using a Linux, VLC player is the best option available. It is available all platforms, and yeah, it supports a wide variety of media formats. Okay, next comes the Caden Live. Now this is very important software for all the teachers and any other person who wish to create videos. Okay, so we normally use softwares which gives us a free editing. Okay, like there are many softwares that will add the effects on its own and create a nice video output and give you. Okay, but those who want to have customized effects or those who want to add effects on their own or create a good film, a good presentation or a good lesson, you can definitely opt for Caden Live. Okay, a powerful video editor, editing software available free for use. Okay, Caden Live is a video editor which is definitely free for use and it is a very powerful tool in the hands of a teacher to create effective lessons. Interface is similar to that of Adobe Premiere Pro. Most of the features available on Premium Pro is available here. Okay, so like you can see, I will show you the images later, allows to work in layers. Again, the layer is kind of a technical term wherein you work in different videos can be put together and arranged, like a front angle, side angle, wide angle, different types of angles are there. Or just maybe you are presenting a lesson and you can add your PPT on the side in the next layer or show some photographs like that. Okay, so let's see how the software looks. Okay, this is the interface of that software. This is how the software looks. This is the project bin where you can load all your files. Whichever file you want to edit, you can load it in the project bin and then drag it to this space. Now this is the editing space, the workspace where you will be actually working with the editing part. There are two video layers available and two audio layers available, but you can work up to four layers in this software. If you try working in five layers, like five video and five audio, and somewhere there will be a bit of like lag or a glitch in the software's processing, and also it may not function that well. The company is working on it, making those changes, but for now you are limited up to 4 to 5 layers only. So 4 video layers and 4 audio layers makes it work, allows you to work in 8 layers total. Okay, so that is how the software is. Then there is the effects option here, and there is the individual effect you can see here. If you have selected a particular video, its effects which are put will be visible here, and these are the different transform and correction effects that are available. And this is your output screen where you will see what your video is currently looking like. Okay, so let's see. Okay, so this is a video which I was editing sometime back. And this, see, you can see different files I have loaded in this project bin. Okay, this is the effects column. And these are the layers. And I'm working on 6 layers in this videos. Okay, there are 3 video layers and 3 audio layers in my video. Okay, whichever I am editing. So you can see the audio layers are all in vertical, like downwards. And the video layers are named upwards. So V1 and A1 are next to each other. Then V2 and A2 are corresponding, and again V3 and A3 are corresponding to each other. Okay, so you can edit. You can see there are different. This is my base video. I have added some. This is my base video. This is my base audio. And I have added some soundtracks, sound effects. I have added some different shots here and there. Okay, then I have added some images also. So these are the different layers how you can work on while using the video editing softwares. Okay, next coming to Mozilla Firefox. Mozilla Firefox is a just excuse me 1 minute. Yeah, okay, so Mozilla Firefox is very similar and alternative to Google Chrome or Microsoft Edge or Internet Explorer, which we normally use. But many people also use Mozilla Firefox. But those who do not know, Mozilla Firefox is a very efficient browser and it is very fast also. So there won't be any speed or lag in the usage. And you can use it effectively like Google Chrome. And it supports many of the add-ons or the apps which are available on Google Chrome are also there on the Firefox. You can definitely give it a try. Okay, so this is how the interface looks like. It is very similar to Google Chrome. But instead of the Chrome logo, you will have the Firefox logo. And you can see the new window, private window, that is the incognito mode which we have in Google Chrome is available. You can save the tab, you can print, history, options and add-ons. Yeah, as I had said, add-ons are available. Now, add-ons are very important when we are doing something on internet. So, it is always good to have some add-ons like the VPN or like that. Or maybe Grammarly. And there are various YouTube downloaders. So, many of them have their own add-ons available. And it is also available on Mozilla Firefox. Okay, so now this is the Audacity. Audacity is a software which is used for audio editing. As you can see, it has different tracks in it, and then okay, so this is a software which is commonly used for audio editing, and it is a free open source software. It allows you to like work on 2-3 more tracks. You can see there are various options also available here, like solo track or a stereo track, mono track, left and right. So you can create effects also, like the sound effect which goes from left to right, so things like that. And you have different effects option available here, like amplify, then noise reduction and all other things are there. So anybody who wish to create a good video can use this software for recording your audio, and then using the Audacity, the Kdenlive software, you can merge the audio with the video and have a good video output. Okay, so then finally we have the Open OBS, that is the Open Broadcaster software. Now, those who have attended all our sessions since yesterday, you must have thought to some extent that how we were doing the live streaming. You must have seen that we were screen sharing. One of our college professor was screen sharing the live from the college onto the Google Meet, and that thing was going onto YouTube. Now, this is quite a bit of complicated process, but it was all happening through OBS. Okay, the input of those, the dignitaries who were sitting on the sofa in the college, along with the podium and the host over there who was comparing, they were being recorded into the camera which was connected to a tripod. The input was taken into OBS and various editing was done to it, and that output product was then put onto the Google Meet via screen sharing. Okay, so and audio also was connected in a different way by which we could easily stream the things. Okay, now OBS also allows you things like chroma key. You must have seen various film photos wherein the film stars are working on a green curtain. Okay, so the green curtain, the green color which they are using is basically used to delete the background. Okay, it is used to delete the background. So we had the same setup installed in our college, and similarly we were using the OBS software to edit the background and make the presenters or the speakers for today's panel discussion as well as yesterday's inaugural look very effective. Okay, all the background and everything was created using the OBS software. So excellent software to manage various scenes and sources at a time, high potential for educational purposes and content development. Okay, so right now also I am live streaming on YouTube and as well as presenting on Google Meet. Both this is happening simultaneously because of OBS software. So we are using it here also to share on YouTube as well as on Google Meet. Okay, so that is done. High potential for educational purposes. You can see there are various options available on OBS wherein you can have your video of you talking along with the PowerPoint and along with something else also in the same scene. Okay, so if once you get used to it, it is good software, usually used to broadcast or live stream on social media platform. Okay, so earlier, before actually the pandemic came, even we were not aware of this software to this extent. We just knew that there is something called as OBS. But this pandemic has really brought us to think upon different softwares which are available, and OBS was one of the most useful software which I ever felt throughout these days, okay, throughout the pandemic time. So OBS, Open Broadcaster Software, It is usually used for broadcasting, okay, live streaming. So you can see on the news channels, there are various interfaces that are coming. Like the news, suddenly below the captions will come, suddenly some image will appear here and there. Okay, so all these are managed using broadcasting softwares, and OBS is also one of the most powerful broadcasting software. Not so user friendly. Yeah, this I would definitely agree to. It is not very user friendly because the software has requires a medium level of computer literacy to operate it. So if you are using only Word, Office and some other media softwares like VLC or watching videos using Google Chrome, so then you will find it a bit difficult to use this software. But I would say that many different videos are available and many instructors are also available who can give you a good experience with how to use OBS for educational purposes or to fulfill your needs with the software. Okay, so this is the interface of OBS. This is how the software will look like. Okay, this is the screen just like how we saw in the video editor. There was output screen. So here is where you will see what is happening at that moment. Now these are the scenes. You can add different scenes here. Google Meet, you can add a PowerPoint, you can add some image, you can add some Word file, many scenes you can add. And each scene you can add different sources. So right now while I'm streaming, I have added window capture and audio output capture. So this way you can stream whatever you want and only that part will go out. And any other things that you make, any other changes that you make won't be seen outside. There is this audio mixer wherein all your audios that are there, whether it may be the input, whether it may be the output, it is available there. But they take some time to understand what is audio output and audio input, because the OBS software's understanding about the terms is different than how we understand. Okay, so whatever is output for us, sometime it appears as an input for the software, and whatever is input for us sometime appear as the output for the software. So you have to think according to the software's perspective and not according to your own thinking. Okay, there is the scene transition, effect setting and other controls. Okay, so once you use, you can see this is how your screen will appear. Okay, open broadcasting software and then you can control all other things there. Even if once you go to the settings option, you will see different settings like general setting and streaming setting. The stream setting is The stream setting is important while you are doing live streaming on YouTube or Facebook or Instagram or any other channel which you have. Output rate you can decide in this software. Audio setting, video setting, and there are various different settings in advanced settings. So if you are familiar with computer terms, you can definitely explore this software or take help from someone who knows this software. Yeah. Okay, now this, the last software, that is the GreenShot. Okay, not last software, next software is GreenShot. GreenShot is a effective and free screen capture software. All the pics in this PowerPoint are taken using GreenShot. Okay, so whatever photos you all saw till now were all taken using the GreenShot software. It is a free. Now in mobile, we have the power button and the volume button. If you click together, we get a screenshot. But on laptop, that is not that effectively possible. Okay, so for that we have this GreenShot software, which is a free open source software, and it allows you to capture full window. You can capture a full screen or a selected area. Okay, various capture options it will allow you. Okay, it does not do recording, but it will only take images. You can definitely download this software. Okay, coming to the next part. Okay, this is the second last slide. Okay, I will be coming to the end now soon. So free open source, free operating system. Okay, FOSS operating systems. Now just like we have Windows and we don't want to pay for Windows, we use crack version of Windows. Instead, we can use the free open source software operating systems like Linux, Fedora or Ubuntu. Okay, the names may sound a bit funny, but they are very effective softwares and they are very highly functioning, as good as Windows. And all the free open source softwares which I have mentioned till now are all available on these operating systems. So, the interface or the functioning of those free open source softwares are much better on the Ubuntu and Fedora rather than it is on Windows. So the functions or the processing which is available on Windows, it is much better on the Fedora or Ubuntu, that is the Linux based operating system. So it is a good alternative to Windows and good compatibility with free open source software use. Okay, so same thing what I had said, and there is a more variety of softwares available for the free operating systems rather than that is available for Windows or Apple devices. Yeah, okay, so now last slide. So these are some of the extra softwares which I would like to share with you all. That is the OpenShot video editor. If you find KdenLive difficult to use, you can first go for OpenShot video editor, which is free. Okay, and it has also many different features like the KdenLive, so you can try on it first. Then there is the Apache Office.org. There is the Apache Office, like the LibreOffice. Similarly, there is this Apache Office, and it has a special language pack also. So if you are using something in local languages, it should support some of the regional languages as well. Same way how Microsoft has a variety of languages, Apache Office also provides you a variety of languages. Then there is the Moodle, which we all know is a learning of management system. Though Moodle allows you to buy their data space on cloud, you can also install a server in your institution and install Moodle on it. It is totally free. And there is this GeoGebra, which is another mathematical software, calculator and typing software available for math people. Okay, it is also a free open source software. And finally, there is Blender, which is a 3D animation software. So you can design 3D models, 3D effects, workspaces or any design, a car, maybe a functioning engine, something like that. All those things can be designed on Blender. Okay, using Blender, that is the 3D animation software. Finally, I would like to conclude with a small quote, that is, technology is a useful servant but a dangerous master. So we must all remember this. It is open for interpretation, but I would like to just say that even if you are using some technology, you must not let it take over you. You have to be the master of that technology. So thank you very much for listening to me all this while. I hope my presentation was in some way useful to y'all and y'all get to learn something new. And this is my contact. You can contact me anytime for any queries if you have or doubts if you have. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Saish. On the different types of open softwares, highly useful for in this panic situation. And now time for asking questions. If you have any questions, you can share now. So now time for asking questions. Participants, please. Hello. Okay, thank you, Saish, for your lecture. So now we will move on to the conference report presentation. So I invite Gureti Falcon, Director of Extension Services, Dada Vidya College of Education, Goa University. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, resource persons, research scholars, academicians, and students from various parts of the globe. It is my pleasure to present the report of the 2 days World Conference on Education entitled Education for the 21st Century, a Blended Perspective, held on 13th and 14th August 2020 here at GVM's Dr. Dada Vaidya College of Education, Farmagudi, Ponda, Goa, India. The conference attracted over 2,000 participants from Asia, Africa, and Europe, and 90 research papers were presented by research scholars. The first day of the conference, the inaugural session started off with the welcome address by Mr. Sanjayan T.S., the secretary of the organizing committee. In order to maneuver successfully in the 21st century, the keynote speaker, Dr. Anna Nina George, in charge principal, spoke about the concept of the four C's in education, namely critical thinking and problem solving, communication, collaboration, creativity, and innovation. During the inaugural session of the conference, Dr. Anna Nina George released the book entitled Status on Quality of Teacher Educator in the State of Goa as Perceived by Teachers, Heads, and Teacher Educator. The book has been written by Dr. Jojen Matthew and is based on the UGC-sponsored project conducted by him recently. Dr. Jojen said that quality teachers determine the quality of the way of life of the nation. The findings of this present book will help the policymakers to improve the quality of education in our state as well as our country. Professor Alan Abreu, ex-dean, Faculty of Education and principal of GVM's Dr. Dada Vaidya College of Education, in his address, said that during the pandemic, the college has organized webinars at local level, state level, national level, and now global level, which was the need of the hour. And as this form of online education would help in the delivery and understanding of education in the 21st century in a much better way. In the first session, the speaker, Professor T. Thanaraj, professor in education, Sri Lanka, spoke on privatization of higher education in Sri Lanka. He pointed out the need to promote privatization of higher education as well as the positive side and the challenges ahead. This was followed by the paper presentation sessions. We have had five sessions running parallel where participants from various parts of the world presented their research papers. The chairperson for these five sessions were Dr. Deepa Varghese, Dr. J. Linson Raj, Dr. Prakash Ahir, Dr. K. S. N. Prasangani, and Mr. Udesh Natikar. The speaker, for the second session was Professor Richard Bose, Professor Emeritus of Inclusive Education, University of Northampton, UK. He spoke on the impact of COVID-19 on marginalized families and children, the situation now and in the future. He also threw light on the challenges ahead, namely economic, social, as well as educational. And he also explained our roles as professionals. The second day started with the session by Dr. Murali Krishnan from MES Assamabi College, Kodungallur, University of Calicut, Kerala. He spoke elaborately on the topic Assessment of Higher Education Institution, NAC Perspectives. In the afternoon session, we had a very fruitful panel discussion on education. The four panelists were Dr. Jojen Matthew, Associate Professor, and he dealt with factors affecting academic achievement in school children. Mr. Ganesh Chandra Naik, Associate Professor, enlightened us on action research for school teachers. Mr. Sunil Kumar, Associate Professor, dealt with the topic Dimensions in Education. And Mr. Sanjay Govekar, Associate Professor, threw light on life skills for education. This was followed by the paper presentation. Again, we had another five parallel sessions of paper presentation. The chairpersons were Dr. Russell D'Souza, Dr. Preeti Oza, Dr. Alka Rani Agarwal, Dr. Savita Mishra, Mr. Sameer Naik. The concluding session was taken by Mr. Saish S. Dalal, and he spoke on free open source softwares for ICT-based education. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Gurati Ma'am, for your brief report on World Conference on Education. So now I announce the best presenter in the World Conference on Education, Priyanka Matthew from Jawaharlal Nehru University, Zakir Hussain Institute of Educational Studies. So she is the best presenter in our World Conference on Education. And so I congratulate her. And we will also send you the book of abstract and edited book soon. Thank you, all of you. Then I invite Dr. Deepa Varghese, Associate Professor, Department of Postgraduate Department of Education, GVM College of Education, Goa University, co-coordinator of this conference, for proposing vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to all. It's my proud privilege to propose vote of thanks on this august occasion of the World Conference conducted by Postgraduate Department of Education and Research Center with the Department of Extension Service of GVM's Dr. Dadavidya College of Education, Goa. Let me, first of all, start by giving glory to Almighty God for making this World Conference on Education a resounding success. My heartfelt thanks to all managing committee members of GVM's College of Education, especially to the chairman of the committee, Sri Bhaskar Khande Parkar, a person with great vision on education who provides all support and guidance to conduct this conference in a fruitful way. Thank you, sir. Next, I extend my sincere gratitude towards very respected Dr. Anna Nina George, officiate principal of our college, who delivered an excellent inaugural address. Ma'am is an awesome personality, having an ignited mind, whose meticulous planning and execution made this conference such a successful and a productive one. Ma'am demonstrated initiative and involvement at every step and made the task very easy. Thank you so much, ma'am. We are truly blessed to get warm and mind-blowing felicitation from our former principal and Dean, Faculty of Education, Goa University, very respected Dr. Alan J. Abreu. He is an enthusiastic and versatile personality with lots of insight and vision. He is the pioneer to establish MMAT course in our college. With great respect, we extend our sincere gratitude for being with us and guiding us. Thank you so much, sir. Now, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to valuable guest speakers, namely Professor Tanraj, Professor Richard Rose, Dr. Murali Krishna, and our Saish Naik Dalal. All of them are joining with us from very long distance and spared their time from their busiest schedule to grace this occasion and sharing their valuable knowledge. Thank you, professors. Next, I extend my generous thanks to my colleague and organizing secretary of World Conference, Mr. Sanchayan T.S., Assistant Professor, MR Department, GVM College of Education. Actually, this World Conference is the brainchild of Mr. Sanchayan. He is a man of enthusiasm, high energy, and he visited more than 15 countries as a guest speaker. He already conducted so many national and international conferences. Actually, he's an asset to our college. Hats off you, Sanchayan sir, for organizing an excellent world conference on education in most successful way.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
We are so grateful to all eminent panel discussion members, Dr. Jojan Matthew, Professor Ganesh Chandra Naik, Professor Sunil Kumar, Professor Sanjay Govekar. They are all really highly informative and interesting and persisting in audience minds. Thank you so much, professors. I also wish to express my grateful thanks to chairs of various sessions, namely Dr. Linson Raj, Dr. Prakash Hare, Dr. K.S.N. Prasangani, Professor Uddesh Natekar, Dr. Russell D'Souza, Professor Preeti Osa, Dr. Alka Rani Agarwal, Dr. Savita Mishra, Professor Samir Naik. All are spent their precious time with us giving valuable opinions to the paper presenters. I also thank the host, that our own MR students, who controlled the session in a highly disciplined way. Dear friends, this world conference like this cannot happen overnight. The wheels start rolling weeks ago. It requires planning and bird's eye for details. For that, we have been fortunate enough to be backed by a team of very motivated, highly dedicated students from postgraduate department under the leadership of vibrant personality, Mr. Saish Naik Dalal, who is also the resource person of the previous session. My sincere gratitude to Saish for his involvement and willingness to take on completion of task beyond his comfort zone. Without Saish and team, I specially mentioned the team members, Sienna Fernandez, Vishesh Patelkar, Ashish Naik, Ghassal Aga, Mansi Bhakel, Surekha Patil. Without them, the World Conference will not be a grand success. I highly appreciate their willingness and involvement they expressed to finish this task. I recognize with gratitude the significant contribution of my colleague, Mr. Deepthech Vernekar, who has been the backbone of the conference, who provide all the technical support for the successful organization of this program. Actually, the flawless session of the webinar is the result of 11 hours tireless effort done by Mr. Deepthech Vernekar along with Nikhil Dikolkar, Ashish Naik, and Prachada Kablekar. I extend my sincere gratitude to Professor Karuna Satyadharkar, a member of organizing committee, for her wholehearted cooperation. Also, organizing committee sincerely recognize and thankful to the professors of our college, Professor Samir Naik, Shaunak Pagi, Hani Babu, and Akshada Samant for their constant support. I place on record my deep sense of gratitude to Goretti Falk, organizing committee member and coordinator of Extension Service Department, who had presented the report of the conference diligently, and also thankful to other members of Extension Service for their kind cooperation. A big thanks to Ms. Siddhi Naik for her effort towards anchoring the inaugural session. With gratitude, I remember our office staff and multitasking staff who were very, very supportive for any obstacle that conference faced. Finally, we are all highly thankful to all paper presenters and participants for joining with us virtually to attend the conference and made this conference a great success. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor Dr. Deepa Varghese, for your enlightening words and the bouquet of thanks to all virtual participants. And I express my sincere thanks to all faculties, virtual participants, professors, chairpersons, scholars for attending and making this world conference a grand success. Thank you. Thank you once again. Thank you. So you can leave now. Thank you. Thank you once again. Bye. Have a nice day.